Hello everyone, Adam Taxin here with Mickey Kuhn here in Naples, Florida. We are talking about some victories lately. We'll inevitably talk about his career as well, but he's been nice enough to join me for an interview, I guess an hour, even though you'd rather be in Boston right now.
Oh.
You know, the parade starts in about an hour.
Sharing the gala.
But Mickey has a lot to say, including about politics. I guess you're not that worried about being blacklisted by the liberals up there these days.
I
don't think you ever were worried. Yeah, he's very deplorable. And thank you for joining me, but let's get
Adam,
to what's on.
My pleasure.
Always a pleasure. We've done a few of these interviews, but never on video. And, you know, I'm still becoming better and better at doing these Facebook Live videos, so I'm going to periodically check and make sure the picture and sound are okay. And I really appreciate if anyone is watching, putting it in the comments if there is a problem with the sound or picture, though I may be unsophisticated enough that I may have disabled the comments accidentally.
Uh-oh.
But, hey, well, let's start with the game. When you're talking, I'll slip over on that side, but tell me about your thoughts about two nights ago.
Oh, my goodness. Of course, going into it, I predicted that the Pats would have 40 points by the end of the first quarter, and then just coast the next three. What a shock that was. My poor wife almost had apoplexy. She knew it was all over with. My very dear friend, Joey Mangine, who we watch Patriots with every Sunday during the season, he was up here, and he predicted it would be 30 points at the first quarter. He left at the half. He said, "I just can't watch anymore." But I, a big fan of Malcolm Butler's, I even have his jersey, I said, I'm one of the faithful. I'm staying till the very end because I knew Tom Brady, the greatest quarterback of all time, would win this ball game.
And you've been alive for a while, so that's a lot of quarterbacks you've seen.
I have. My first quarterback I can remember was a fellow by the name of Bob Waterfield in 1946. Came from Cleveland to L.A. I remember quarterbacks before that, but Bob Waterfield was really the first. But I have an interesting story. I can go back to Otto Graham.
I want to give them some background. Now, Mickey is originally from the LA area. That's why he was a childhood actor. But he spent most of his life, I guess after you were in the Navy,
yes,
in the South Shore of Massachusetts?
North Shore.
North Shore.
Marblehead.
Oh, Marblehead's the North Shore. I should know that. And a lot of you may be really confused because your most famous role is as Bo Wilkes, Melanie's son, and at 7 years old and Gone with the Wind.
That's right.
And so you say, wait, I'm confused. Clayton County, Georgia, that's Atlanta.
Atlanta.
Bo Wilkes would be a Falcons fan. Not that the Falcons existed until 1967. I think the movie took place in like 1862.
Exactly.
But, you know, some people may have thought that you'd be a Falcons fan. Though, interestingly, the Falcons' big rival is the New Orleans Saints.
Oh.
And your other big role was in most famous movie role, but bigger roles in other movies, is in A Streetcar Named Desire. And the kid you played there would have been a Saints fan.
Saints fan. That's exactly
right. But they didn't come in the league until like 1967 either.
Yeah. I was, when I moved to Boston in 1984.
Keep going, I'm just checking. Keep talking. Ron Higgins, is the sound and picture working okay?
Great. We're lucky to
comment in there.
When I moved to Boston in 1984, I became a Pats fan. I was a Rams fan even when I was in Washington, and now had to be the Patriots. I'll tell you, I have a shrine to them in my garage.
We're going to go see that later.
Oh, okay.
Continue this, but they have to sit through all this to get to that fun part.
Yeah, it's I'm proud of it. Now I have to make room for one more bit of memorabilia, because thank goodness for the fifth.
Right?
Yeah.
And that's a problem Eagles fans like us don't have in their garages. We don't have to make any Super Bowl victory shrines, that's for sure. Though the one you guys took 12 years ago should have probably been ours, but we're not going to get into that right here.
Well, whatever you
little,
say, Adam.
Cheating. Yeah, right. So wait, you said you became a Pats fan in 84.
That's correct.
That's interesting because that was the Dickerson years in L.A. You could have like gone to some Rams bars in Marblehead, Massachusetts. I don't know if the Rams really have that much of a national following.
But then.
The Patriots were not very good then.
Oh,
they got good quickly in 85.
Yep.
But
I attended several games, Patriots games, down in Foxborough,
mm-hmm.
When the old stadium, sitting on the old cement seats. And I worked for American Airlines, and one of my flight attendants was married to a that was that played for the Philadelphia Eagles, John Outlaw. He was a defensive back. So when they came to Boston, John always managed to get me a couple of tickets to go to the game.
Man, play them that often? Well, no, maybe they did play often because, like, you would play the other last place teams, like the way they'd set up the season. And the Eagles and Patriots probably were both in last place a lot around then. So they probably played a couple times over a short period.
Right.
So they did make the Super Bowl in '85. Not a great team, as we saw in the Super Bowl.
Yeah, they got beaten by
a wild card. Yeah, they got hot at the right time.
Yeah.
So, okay, so it's a three decades long. So the majority of your history as a Pats fan has been a pretty successful
That's
one.
That's it. Like, yeah. It's a three-decade love affair with the New England Patriots.
Good. You said Brady's the best of all time. Are you a Belichick guy? Are you a Kraft guy, too? Any other favorites?
Well, I am, because Mr. Kraft saved the Patriots. Earthwine wanted to move them to St. Louis.
Right.
And Mr. Kraft came in, who's been his lifetime has been a Pats fan.
He's from Boston, yeah.
Yeah. He said, no. He said, Patriots aren't moving to St. Louis. I'm going to buy them. And he did. Needless to say, his investment has increased significantly.
Yeah, I'd say they're probably one of the three most popular national franchises. Obviously, the success is a part of their up there with the Steelers and the Cowboys.
Exactly.
Now,
in all humility, I have to agree.
Yeah. Oh, Steelers still are number one in terms of all popularity for whatever reason. So it's been a good year. I assume you're very pleased with the relationship that President Trump has with Kraft, Brady, and Belichick.
I'm absolutely ecstatic. I know all the stuff that went on during the campaign, and it was, bad things were said. And I've been I've been following presidential campaigns that I can remember as far back as 1940, when Wendell Willkie was running against Franklin Roosevelt.
That was when you were 8 years old?
Yeah. I mean, I can remember that. And I told my wife, Barbara, I said, I have never in my lifetime been exposed to such a vile, foul, filthy campaign as this one. But I didn't care. My man won. I'm a deplorable. And I'm a Republican, and whoever my candidate was, I voted for.
Were you a Trump guy from the start, or were you?
No.
Who were you for?
I kind of had hopes for Carly Fiorina.
Carly Fiorina?
I did. I liked Carly. I thought she could take on the other candidate and just take her to lunch every day, every time they met.
Right.
But then when the Donald was nominated, he became my candidate, and I supported him, still do, 100%. I think everything he's done and is doing is right.
Do you like how upset the liberals are getting, and it's like a new topic every day he's giving them? Like, they're always on the run, they're always protesting.
I wish they'd get over it. It isn't going to change for 4 years, maybe eight, I hope. I wish they'd get over it, because it's not going to achieve anything except hard feelings sometimes between family members,
right,
and sometimes between good friends. Thank God, Adam and I see eye to eye.
That's for sure. Now, people will say, that's interesting, because people who spent time in Hollywood, they're forced to be liberal. It's even when, a couple years ago when you were out there doing the main part of your career out there, it was even liberal back then. You had a lot of commies out there, McCarthy wasn't wrong.
That's one of the reasons I got out of the business.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I couldn't take some of the liberal thinking, even though I was young and it really didn't affect me one way or the other. But I could. It just wasn't me. Mm-hmm. I had different thoughts, different ideas.
And that's interesting, because you got your butt kicked on screen by one of the big Hollywood conservatives of all time. Maybe you could tell us a little bit about that. John
Duke.
Wayne.
Duke. Yes. What a nice man. Never forget that day. It was in Arizona.
Well, we got to give them a little background on Red River.
Ah, okay. I was fortunate enough to appear in the movie Red River with John Wayne, Montgomery Clift, Walter Brennan, Joanne Drew. I was selected to play Montgomery Clift as a young boy. And how I was selected, I don't know, but I thank God that I was. The scene that we're talking about, for those of you that may have seen Red River, was where John Wayne knocks the gun out of my hand and slaps the tar out of me. Well, yes, he did. After about 5 rehearsals, he came up to me and he said, "Mick," he said, "would you mind terribly if I really connected with you?" He said, "It would look great on camera." I said, "Whatever you say, Mr. Wayne." He was 6'4", I'm 5'3", 2", something like that. So he did, we did the take, he smacked me once, and that was the last one. We only did one take. But, and when we saw the rushes 2 days later, he came up to me and he stuck his hand out and said, "Congratulations, Mick, you did a fine job." I've never washed this hand since 1945, right here.
And you also, it was limited interaction, but you did do a scene in Gone with the Wind with Leslie Howard. I don't know much about his politics, but he certainly was patriotic British, not American, and he passed away, your father in the movie, during World War II, serving the British World War. And he was a big star, yet serving Great Britain at that time.
And he was serving in MI6 in Great Britain at the time.
Which is not something Hollywood actors do too much today.
Not really, they don't.
Well, what's your reaction when you see someone like Shia LaBeouf? I don't even know if you even bother thinking about him much. Or like some of the Hollywood actors, Meryl Streep, just mouthing off. Does it embarrass the profession as a whole?
It disappoints me because Meryl Streep was one of my favorites, if not my absolute favorite, talented, highly respected actress. And when they get that vocal about politics in something, an award ceremony, it just, I'm sorry. Mm-hmm. It hurts me, and I lose a certain amount of respect for it. They're free to do whatever they want, and anytime, any place, anywhere. But I always had hoped that the big classy stars would have a little more discretion in their political expression.
Oh, and De Niro, like, talking like a tough guy, like he's going to knock Trump out. So frankly, I would take Trump in that fight. seeing both of them, but he's talking a big game right now.
Yeah, you know, and De Niro got his big claim to fame was the Raging Bull.
Right.
And I think maybe he's still at 60-some-odd, 70-some-odd years, is still maintaining a little bit of that thought in the back of his head.
Yeah. Of course, he was playing a role in a movie, actually boxing.
That's right, playing a role in a movie, but, you know, when you start talking like some of these people do, they forget they're not playing a role in the movie. They're out there in front of their fans, and their fans may not think that much of it.
Yeah, I think he may be more in real life equivalent to Travis Bickle, a little crazy, and he's a big tough guy when he's talking to the mirror. You're talking to me. You're talking to me, President. Exactly. Yeah, let's see how tough he is in real life.
Yeah.
You know what? It's funny you mentioned the protest because you're a big NFL fan. I can imagine he's not going to be your favorite guy in the league. But ironically, Meryl Streep mouth off that way. Colin Kaepernick didn't even really open his mouth. He just sat during the national anthem. And as a naval veteran, you must have some opinions on that. Even though he really didn't say anything, he just quietly, passively didn't stand for the anthem. But you must have some feelings about all of that. And the fact that the NFL has taken so much of a hit, ratings-wise and popularity-wise, just from that.
Yeah, I do, Adam. I'm a Navy vet from Korea. God bless all of you, and thank you all for being with me there, and World War II, and Vietnam, and all of this stuff going on around the world. It's a source of pride. We're fighting for the flag. That's what we fought for. The national anthem is our song, and we have to respect it. To give off with a display like Mr. Kaepernick did, I lost respect for him as a person. He's entitled to do whatever he wants, but he should thank God this is his country and he's able to do that. Those of us that were in the military gave up our time at home, and some of us made the big sacrifice so he could do that. He has no respect for the military or the United States of America, nor I for him.
On the bright side, he didn't make it worse by voting for Hillary.
Oh!
He didn't even vote. He also had a 2-14 record without being that bad a quarterback this year. And then the thing that was great, I can't even be mad at him because, I mean, Castro oppressed the people of Cuba so long.
He did.
Kaepernick's karma was so bad that when he went to Miami and actually wore a Castro t-shirt, like a very in-your-face thing to do in Miami in particular,
bad choice.
Castro died 3 days later. It's like, it was impossible to really be mad. The guy was just a schmuck.
I know. He just, you know, well, that, you know, some people are just unfortunate in the fact that they don't use their heads.
The anti-Brady. And I was talking with someone yesterday about Patriots Online, and it was just like, you could see that the Patriots had so much confidence in Brady. But not only that, it was like just knowing he was on the other side made the Falcons think, we might not win this. It made them hesitant. It made them tentative. It made them do stupid stuff like, you know, taking that sack, which put him out of field goal range. But I kind of have to think, it might be the other way around for Kaepernick. You know, I know we're behind, but Kaepernick will do something stupid in the fourth quarter, and we have a chance to win this thing.
Exactly. You know, see, the Patriots just wore the Falcons down. They were a young team. They're a great team, fast. They'll be there again. In fact, I think some odds makers in Vegas are saying next year's Super Bowl will be the Pats and the Falcons once again. But
Carolina will be back next year in that division. Usually, the Falcons didn't even make the playoffs last year. It's usually a team no one expects for one of the spots.
But, you know, Tom Brady's been there 7 times, and he knows exactly what to do, where to go, what will work, what won't work, based on what's happened earlier in the game. He's fantastic.
Here's a thought. Now, if I can break it off sports. You always have such good stories about the industry, and you've remained close with your... There are very few celebrities who are over 100 years old right now. Right. One of my favorites is Herman Wouk. You got Beverly Cleary, Kirk Douglas, who I don't think you ever worked with.
I did.
Oh, you did work with Kirk Douglas.
Yes, I did.
Oh, well, before I even get to that point, let's go talk about, where did you work with Kirk Douglas?
I was fortunate enough to play Kirk Douglas as a boy in his first movie, The Strange Love of Martha Ivers.
Oh, I never even saw
Barbara Stanwyck. And you know the cleft he has in his chin, it took a little bit of molding to create a cleft in my chin, even as a young boy. But yeah, I kind of told a friend of mine, I said, you know, I'm fortunate I have appeared in movies with 2 100-year-old movie stars.
I think there only are 2 100-year-old movie stars at this point. Have you been in movies with both 100-year-old movie stars? I may be overlooking someone, but I think there are only 2. The other we'll get to in a second is Olivia de Havilland, who you've kept up with through the years, who was your mother in Gone with the Wind. And not only that, you were in Vivien Leigh's 2 biggest movies.
You're the only
person who's done that. That's A Streetcar Named Desire and Gone with the Wind, obviously.
Yeah, I'm the only actor in Hollywood who is fortunate enough to have appeared in both of her Academy Award winners.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Olivia de Havilland is interesting because she turned 100 like over half a year ago.
July 1st.
July 1st. And she's 100 now, and which is very ironic because, I mean, that really stands out. Not to say you weren't one of the biggest actors in Gone with the Wind, but you were on screen for like 30 seconds.
30 seconds.
Yeah.
Right.
But the other, I mean, they really all died untimely
deaths,
except for maybe Prissy lived into their 60s, I guess.
She
died in a fire,
house fire.
Right?
Yeah, in Harlem.
But she's the only one who even made it to 60, right?
She did not, no.
She didn't make it to 60. Mm-hmm. Hattie McDaniel died young, too?
Breast cancer.
Died in her 50s, maybe?
Yeah. Yeah.
Vivien Leigh died in her 50s?
Vivien was 52.
Oh, wow.
What a late. She's my sweetheart.
We'll go through the list. Leslie Howard died in World War II.
World War II.
And Clark Gable, was in his 50s by then?
He was 60 years old.
He was 60.
I think he died just before his 60th birthday. Yeah. And as a sidelight there, I have appeared at the Golden Boot Awards with his son, John Clark. John came up to me, we were chatting, and he said, Mick, he said, you knew my dad, didn't you? And I said, yeah, I did, John. I was fortunate enough to know him. And he said, can you tell me a little bit about him? And it was a bit sad because he never knew his dad. He was born several months after his father died.
I didn't know that.
Yeah.
So what did you tell him?
I just told him about, you know, my relationship on the set with him and how kind he was to me as a child actor. And unfortunately, John Clark has had a tough life, and I wish him all the best if he's still with us.
You mentioned something interesting to me another time, that it was very funny the way Clark Gable and Vivian Leigh interacted on the set of Gone with the Wind. Like, they had this hot romance on screen, right. And when they were not doing that, they would be playing cards together.
You know, yeah, you know, the code for an actor, to be a good actor, you have to be able to make love to a bedpost. And that's the theory. If you were a director, we were in a big movie, and you said, Mickey, you've got to make passionate love to that palm tree behind us. Well, if I couldn't do it, then I wouldn't be much.
That's a pretty good-looking palm tree over there. So you can't see it on camera.
It has some nice curves.
Yeah. It's definitely thin.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
As they all tend to be. And you loved working with Vivian Leigh as well?
Oh, Vivian Leigh. She was wonderful. May I tell a little story?
Absolutely.
We were shooting down in New Orleans, Louisiana. It was all night work. And after the scene was rehearsed several times, Mr. Kazan said, okay, we'll shoot in a couple of minutes. And Lady Olivier said, well, I need a break. So she went to her dressing room. And I mentioned to one of the crewmen, I said, you know, this is quite a thrill for me. I said, I appeared with Lady Olivier 11 years ago in Gone with the Wind. And I said, and here I am now with her again in Streetcar Named Desire. And about 10 minutes later, the assistant director says, okay, people, take a half-hour break. I said, okay. And this same crew member came up to me and said, Mickey, Lady Olivier wants to see you in her dressing room. Needless to say, my heart sank, Adam. I mean, I thought my career was over. I was 18 years old on my first trip location away from my parents, my mother. So I racked my brain. What did I do? Where did I go wrong? What did I say? Well, contrary to all my worries, I get over there and knock on the door, and Lady Olivier says, come in. I walked in the door, and she said, oh, Mickey, how nice to see you. She said to her assistant, she said, called her by name and said, please, leave Mickey and me alone for a few minutes. We want to talk about old times. What a thrill. You know, this is Vivian Leigh. And we did. We chatted about old times. We chatted about Gone with the Wind. We chatted about my career. We just had a wonderful time. Of course, I was shaking in my boots the whole time because here I am in a dressing room with an icon. And what a thrill.
I'm sure. Yeah. Let's hear a little bit about your relationship with your on-screen mother in Gone with the Wind. That, of course, is Olivia de Havilland, Melanie Wilkes, Hamilton.
I call her Mama Melanie
now. Melanie Hamilton Wilkes. I'm sorry, I said it wrong.
I call her Mama Melanie, although she and I never appeared together on screen.
She was busy dying.
She was busy dying behind the door, and Leslie Howard's carrying me out. I'm crying and on and on. Leslie Howard said, when we were rehearsing, Leslie Howard said to Victor Fleming, well, how are we going to get him to cry? And Victor Fleming says, don't you worry about that. I'll take care of it. And he did. We went back in behind the door, which was Mama Melanie's bedroom. He created a very, very sad story for me. And I started crying. We came out. He handed me to Leslie Howard. We shot the scene, one take, thank goodness. And when it was over, Leslie Howard said to Victor Fleming, now what do I do? Victor Fleming said, don't worry, I'll take care of it. So he takes me back behind the door, and he's talking me down, and I quit crying. And he said to me, Mickey, he said, would you feel better if you hit me? I said, yes, I'm 6 years old. And so I threw a left at him, and just as I threw it, the studio still photographer was there and took a picture of it.
Oh, wow.
And I have that picture to this day. So it, but anyway.
And then you got payback from John Wayne.
Then I got payback from John Wayne. He got even for everybody. But when Mama Melanie, I was fortunate enough to attend Mama Melanie's, Olivia de Havilland's 90th birthday gala in Hollywood. And although we didn't get much of a chance to talk, we had a picture taken. And from that point on her birthdays, I'd always call her in Paris and send her a card or whatever. And we'd chat. And just she's just such a wonderful, delightful lady. And this time, because I knew she hadn't been that well, I didn't call. But I sent her send her a card and send her a bouquet of flowers for her 100th birthday. And I got the most wonderful email, which she's into now, back from her.
Over 100 she's using email.
Over 100 she's using email. I have 7 letters from her over the years that she had typed and signed personally. So I'm satisfied with the email. But I call her Mama Melanie.
Fun. And how is her health right now?
Very good. She's fragile and frail, but she's back at home, and so I understand. And she has a caregiver there with her. But when I spoke to her just after her 100th birthday, and her mind was just very sharp, very sharp. She doesn't like to talk about her time in the movies. She likes to talk about current events.
Oh, what are her politics? Is she a Trump person?
Well,
Too much time in France.
Yeah, too much time in France.
Well, you know all those Confederates are Democrats anyhow.
That's right. That's right. Even though it was a Republican that freed the slaves.
Well, exactly.
Exactly.
They were on the wrong side. However, Scarlett was the one who interacted with Republicans.
Exactly.
And
exactly.
was concerned with the bottom line. And exactly. who was the one who became rich?
And I don't know why these liberals are so anti- Republican, because they allegedly are prejudiced, like they say of the Donald.
Oh.
Mr. Trump, Mr. President, forgive me. But, you know, it was the Republicans that freed the slaves. So, come on, give me a break.
Well, it's the same Democrat Party exploiting people
yep.
now like they are then. As Scarlett would have said, they won, get over it. Which is basically her attitude in the movie.
Exactly, and I say the same thing. Get over yourselves.
It's true. What if for some reason Donald Trump is tuning in on Facebook Live right now? What advice would you give him right now?
Just continue doing what you're doing, Donald, or Mr. President, and be careful, listen to your advisors, but keep it going, Mr. President.
And which character do you think he would have the most in common with of the big movies? I can't remember John Wayne's name in Red River, or is it more that
Dunson.
Or would he be more Stanley Kowalski that's in Streetcar Named Desire? Or would he be more Rhett Butler? Rhett Butler would have a lot in common with Bill Belichick.
Exactly.
Just win,
and
no matter
way,
how.
By the way,
yeah. or Brady.
Run with the Wind is Bill Belichick's favorite movie.
Is that right?
Yeah, I found that out
a
few years ago.
Are you serious?
That's what
Has
heard.
He talked about Have you not gotten in touch with him?
No.
Wait. Hold on. We got to... Wait, you're like one of the only living actors of his favorite movie
well,
and you've never sent a message?
Maybe he'll be watching
this. No. We got to... How can you not... We were talking before that. How did you not mention that to me?
Because I didn't think about it until... I was talking to another Pats fan who mentioned that on the air. Mentioned it to me. You know, I'm intimidated of famous people.
Something tells me he's more of a Rhett Butler guy than an Ashley guy, as is Brady.
He is. Brady's a combination of Dunson and Rhett Butler.
Remind me a little bit more about Dunson, because I only saw the movie once. And it was
Tom Dunson was the patriarch of Red River. He broke out from a wagon train and took a bull with him. And the wagon train got burned, and this kid, me, had a cow. And we ran into each other, and that's how we formed the ranch. And he had one of the biggest ranches in Texas. Because when he took the property, he said, as far as you can see, and 100 miles beyond is my land, you tell Don Diego not to come on.
That's in Cowboys Country. You know what? It just occurred to me. That's near where I was born. I didn't really grow up there. Wichita Falls, Texas near where Red River took place.
Exactly.
Yeah?
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
So Cowboys fans, a little something for you all, too.
Exactly.
And Broken Arrow, I will mention, we haven't talked about it at all, and I'm going to give you a chance to address Coach Belichick in a second.
Okay.
That, if I remember correctly, I can't even remember who was in it besides you, but it was one of the first movies to teach to treat the Redskins. I'm doing that. That's a joke because it's a football-related video. With some humanity. I mean, it was a little more sensitive. It didn't make them caricatures.
No, nope. It gave him a place in this country. It showed that the biggest savage of the Chiefs was the Apaches were. That he had some intelligence, and you could reason with him and talk with him. When you got on him, he had no time for you. But when you took the time and showed him respect, he had the time for you.
I want to give you a chance so we can make a video. Gone with Living Gone with the Wind actor addresses Bill Belichick. Now that I know that Gone with the Wind's his favorite movie, and this will really rub it in the Falcons fans' face because from Atlanta.
Yeah. Now that's secondhand. That came to me secondhand, and I mean I've never seen anything written about it, quotes from him or the like. But I'll tell you what, Adam, I heard it.
Well, make sure she gets this. I know Meredith Gorman, Boston Herald reporter, I'm going to make sure you get this so you can get this to him. She covers the Patriots, and she's probably one of the prettiest girls I've ever seen in my life. She's like, I'll show you a picture of her. Great.
You know, I don't know if many people know this. Everybody criticizes Bill Belichick for not having a personality, which is fine with me. He's got a job to do, and he does it very well, as was evident the second half of the Super Bowl. But I had the opportunity to attend a function that he spoke at. And he's a completely different person when he's giving a lecture. He likes to tell stories about the team, and he tells you how tough he is and with the team. Not tough, he's strict, and he demands perfection. If you don't want to, as was evident by a couple of Pat players that left in midseason.
Who left again?
Jamie Collins.
Oh, yeah.
And I forget the other one.
But Collins was a significant player.
He was, both of them. Uh-huh. Both of them were significant players. But there was something that didn't go along with Bill Belichick's way of coaching, and gone. Yay, Mr. Belichick, do it again. You have to.
And yet, it's funny, I mean, forget about Aaron Hernandez, but he'll take chances on players who have not necessarily the best reputations. LeGarrette Blount, and it's worked for the Patriots.
That's right. And I have to tell you a quick story. I was watching a game, because I live in Florida and we don't get the Patriots games too often. I have to go either to a golf club or a bar to see the game.
Well, maybe they play at Tampa Bay next year. They always play in Miami.
I know it. I was at watching a game recently, and I saw a player flash across the screen. His name was Van Noy, and I said to a guy sitting next to me, a total stranger, I said, "Who is this Van Noy? I've never seen him before." And he said, "Oh, Bill Belichick saw him hanging around outside Gillette Stadium and says, 'You want to play football for me?' Came in, and he turned out to be a good ball player." I'm kidding, but that's, you know, he can spot talent 100 miles away.
Well, it's not even just talent, it's talent for specific roles.
That's
obviously something Hollywood deals with too. You know, it's not always who the most overall talent is, who's right for that role.
Right. And he knows talent, and he knows people. And if you've got the combination, it's great.
Why do you think it's worked so well with Brady?
Brady's talented. He was a sixth-round draft pick, down somewhere around 160th. In the draft, and unfortunately, Bledsoe had an accident, got injured, and Tom came in and played the game, and they competed the next year for the position. And of course,
did they compete the next year? Didn't he get traded to the Bills in the offseason?
No, I think he got. They competed.
Look
it up. Because I think they competed the next year, and then he got traded.
I think they just traded him to the Bills after that,
they?
So it wouldn't be an ugly situation. Not an ugly situation. Bledsoe was always very classy about it all.
Yeah.
Oh, but, you know, in Philly, we know Donovan McNabb, who sort of ruined the career of other players because the fans liked him more. He really did.
You know, you're probably right, Adam.
I think they traded him, and they could get value for him at that point, but they knew Brady was the man for the future. I love what he said, you know the story, of course, about what he said to Robert Kraft when they first met.
He said,
I'll give you the chance of selling it to the audience.
He said to Robert Kraft when they first met, I'm not going to say it's a quote, but it's there. It says, he said, "I'll not make you disappointed that you drafted me, or this was the best draft pick you ever made." I'm not sure what
I heard it as
was.
Best decision
best
you've ever
decision
made.
Best decision you've ever made. Yeah. He's proven it.
Yeah, I think that was a pretty good decision. I don't know who else went in the sixth round that year, but I don't think anyone got quite the same value.
No.
You know, I got to ask you about the Flategate, what you thought of that, and getting revenge on the NFL and Goodell. And to me, I said at the beginning of the year, I had a funny feeling that, you know, this is going to come back, maybe not bite the NFL in the butt, but work out for the Patriots the right way, because you forget, Brady's 39, he's going to play a 12-game regular season, not a 16-game regular season, and they still got home field advantage.
That's right. And in the first place, the player that got the ball that allegedly was deflated had only touched the ball once in the season up to that point, and that, so he'd only
touched
the
ball. You're talking about the
guy on the Colts. The linebacker. Yeah. He'd never touched the ball all season until he caught that one. And Tom Brady doesn't have to deflate a football to throw it. He came back in the second half of that game, allegedly using deflated footballs, and scored something like 30 or 40 points in the second half. Tom Brady doesn't have to cheat. The Patriots don't have to cheat when they went through their...
Except for spying on the Eagles
except
before
for
that Super Bowl, right?
That, yeah, that's
just
all right.
A sore point.
That's all right. I mean, they had to get a heads up on the Eagles.
Well, superior opponent than they usually play.
And, but the thing is, Roger Goodell wanted to prove a point, and he took the $1 million from Mr. Kraft. He took away two draft choices, and he tried to humiliate Tom Brady, who is too much of a class act to be humiliated by anything. He just got upset, went on a revenge tour, and you know the rest. And now you know the rest of the story.
Yeah, it must, not biased at all whatsoever.
No.
It made it that much more sweet. I wasn't even thinking about that during the final few minutes when I thought to myself, well, all six of the Patriots Super Bowls, that affected my plans. I didn't want to go to a party, which I could have.
Yeah.
I said, I have to be able to watch the game at the end because all six that Brady has been in have gone down to the last minute.
That's it.
Every single one. And as opposed to Denver, Denver's had been in one
Brady,
Super Bowl
Brady's,
that was interesting.
Brady's been in seven.
Yeah, Brady's been in seven, and I said, I know it's going to come down to it,
yeah.
But I didn't even think about that in the last minute. This is the Deflategate revenge Super Bowl.
That's it.
And it just made it that much sweeter, I guess. I mean, as opposed to those really boring Super Bowls, like against Carolina, St. Louis, the Giants, and the Eagles,
yeah.
Like which all went down to the last minute and were great also.
See, in all humility, I like to say, Brady planned it this way.
If anyone could,
to
it
make
would be
it
him.
Exciting. My poor wife was having apoplexy the entire game.
Was he crying?
In fact...
No, he wasn't.
In fact, the last quarter she left, she said, the game is over. And I said, yeah, it is, as soon as Brady scores. And
well,
he did.
White scored, but
James
you
White
got it pretty
scored.
Close. Yeah.
Exactly. But let me ask you this. How long or how many times do you think they practiced the two-point conversion? They practiced and practiced and practiced because during the season, they didn't make a two-point conversion.
They didn't?
No.
How many did they even go for during
I think
the
they went for two. Maybe.
They weren't behind in too many games that they
no,
didn't need to go
but
for.
But they went for it just to see how it would go.
Right. It's not like Pittsburgh where they have a bad kicking surface and
that's
they
right.
regularly go for two-point conversions.
Yeah.
I mean, that's so remarkable. Not only is the comeback, but the odds are very much against you getting two-point conversions. I was saying to myself, and I was rooting for the Patriots because I love – I love the fact that they supported Trump, and I love how generous Kraft, who is a Democrat, but close with Trump, and is extremely generous toward Israel, extremely pro-Israel, and I love, my bias, how they honored the kid who was killed in Israel last year, Ezra, I'm blanking on his last name, they gave him a moment of silence. I mean, that, to me, really touched me.
It, you know, it's only right. That's a one only big, effective ally that we have in the Middle East. And when the last administration voted not to support them in the United Nations, no comment.
Yeah. Not that you were a big fan of the last administration
before that.
All right, let's, I guess, wrap this up. If I'm spending a lot of time in Florida, which I may be the next few weeks, we can always come back to you with more stories or just talking about politics.
Good, please.
But I want to give you a chance to talk about not your acting career. I know what's on your mind right now. It's the Patriots. It's not Trump. It's not your acting career. It's the Patriots. Let me let you finish off with whatever you want to say about the Super Bowl, the Patriots, Belichick, Brady, whoever.
Well, I just want to say that Tom Brady should go into the Hall of Fame the day he retires. I think Bill Belichick, as he was as one of the sportscasters said the other day, Jerry Jones was inducted into the Hall of Fame this most recent class. Bill Belichick should be there too. And that's right, Mr. Belichick. The Patriots, they're just a team. They have one goal, and that's just do your job. And when you do your job, Super Bowl 51 shows you what happens. I love them.
Thank you for less than 48 hours after the Super Bowl coming to talk to me and whoever listens to this. And I guess I should let you go watch the parade now.
Go watch the parade, and let's hope a lot of people look at it. This is great, Adam.
If not, there will be another one next year.
That's it.
Oh, you're talking about this rather than the parade. Yeah. Coach Belichick does.
Yeah, I think Tom and Bill will be there next year. They want to prove something. But then you got to use your thumb for the next ring, you know?
Oh, that's what they say in Pittsburgh.
Yeah,
if he does two more years, then the Patriots will have more Super Bowls than the Steelers.
Exactly.
I guess that's the goal Brady wants to leave on.
Well, you know, I think he wants to play as long as he can. And you know, Blanda played till he was 48 years old.
He's a kicker.
But he's a quarterback.
In the earlier part of his career. Yes, that's true. Yep. But
then he kicked and was quarterback too. Remember that, Adam?
Yeah, he was a quarterback at the beginning. I do remember.
Exactly.
He's before my time, but yes, I'm aware of that.
Yeah, and he wound up just being a kicker, but he was 48. Tom can't kick, but he can sure pass.
That was Flutie who did the drop kick.
And Flutie was 42 when he did that.
Yes.
So Tom's got a long way to go yet. Keep it up, Tom.
I made a dumb mistake that someone sophisticated like, say, Victor Fleming or L.A. Kazan would not have made. I completely forgot, as we discussed, to show off Mickey's shrine to the New England Patriots at his house. So I'm going to take you on a little tour, and some of you may watch this later if you're real fans, because the parade, I think, started already. But there's Mickey, his balloon. There's much more than this. Let me just show you what's flying. Even though he's a very patriotic American, there's only one flag flying up here. You may want to fix that, by the way. Naval veteran, but he can do whatever he wants. He's a naval veteran. So take us on the tour in your garage of your shrine to the Patriots and maybe some of the other things in there.
Fine.
Okay, we got this.
Here we go.
We're following you. I should have included this before, but I forgot. You can do this slowly. Let me show you a few of the other things. Let me just give them some background of you, your acting career. This is Red River in there. That's you in Red River before John Wayne kicks your butt the way, what's his name, Hightower did to Matt Ryan in the fourth
right
quarter.
Right there is where he just kicked it.
Okay, that's afterwards.
Yeah.
Did you see I brought in a Hightower Ryan reference there?
That's it. Broken Arrow.
Broken Arrow, that's you in Broken Arrow. Okay, I'm just setting the stage for some of the other stuff.
Dick Tracy,
yep. Cool. Okay.
That's Bonnie, Tammy King, God rest her soul.
Oh, that's right. She played
Bonnie
Blue Butler, and she played Bambi's girlfriend, right?
Faleen.
Yeah.
This Patrick Curtis, he was the toddler, Bo.
Yeah. A couple years younger. He's still alive, right?
He
living
is.
In St. George, Utah?
My bride.
Another Barbara,
That's Barbara. And then when I got the boot.
When you got the boot. Oh. What happened there?
Kids of the West got the award that year.
What is Kids of the West?
It was the Golden Boot was an award given to cowboy actors for 25 years.
Oh, I didn't know about that.
Yeah, Patrick produced it.
Can we just see your Dick Tracy shrine up there before we get to the main event?
Dick Tracy shrine, that was made for me by Patrick, my friend Patrick Curtis.
Uh-huh.
Do you want to light on that?
Who played the same person as you at a different age in Gone with the Wind.
Yeah, he was a toddler.
And you have plenty more stuff inside.
No, he was the baby.
He was the baby.
Yeah.
And you have plenty more inside, right?
Yeah.
From your career. But we'll save that for another time.
Yeah.
We don't want to distract people from the main event.
Main event.
Where should I start?
Well, this is number four. This is number one here.
Okay, Patriots Avenue.
Yeah.
We love our veterans, so, you know, I got to get the Navy in there, too. You have Adam Vinatieri.
And Tom Terrific.
That was number one. Was the uniform a little lighter shade of blue back then? Did they switch from blue to navy?
I think they did this year.
All right, I think it was a while ago.
Yeah.
I didn't. I noticed they did
that. I know they have the dark blue uniforms because of TV, the contrast.
Is that right?
Yeah, number two.
So they went from a more traditional American blue to a dark.
To be dark, yeah.
That's the kick against Carolina.
Kick against Carolina. Here it is in long. Super Bowl number three.
I don't like that one. This is a sore point. Did they have Donovan McNabb throwing up on the field?
No.
Okay. Freddie Mitchell, if you're watching, you can appreciate that one.
And Deion Branch. He was the MVP.
I am aware of that. No, I don't like that one.
Malcolm Butler.
So that, were you a Malcolm Butler fan before that occurred?
No. After this occurred, I got his jersey. I wear his jersey every game.
Nice. Not bad from a guy for a guy who came from University of West Alabama.
I know.
It's not Michigan, where Brady's from.
Yeah.
We were all Patriots.
Yep.
I don't go over great in Atlanta right now. Or if that one was Seattle.
Yeah.
And you got Seattle. How many?
With all the rings, four rings and eight hats.
Four rings, yeah. Soon only eight. They've won 14 division championships.
Well, I don't collect those. I only do it when they go to the Super Bowl.
Right? Okay. You got
that. And the four rings, replicas, of course.
Yes. All right.
I'm now in the process of...
I'm just going to show this from your aviation career.
Right,
just
American
give you a little credit.
Yeah.
And what did you do for American? Can you tell us?
Yeah, I was in the management team.
I'll switch this back to you.
This we got from the Korean government.
Where you served?
Yep.
In the war. Okay, tell us a little bit about your career at American.
I had a good career. It's 30 years.
I want this in the background.
Had a 30-year career.
Uh-huh.
I started out with them in 1965 on the ramp as a airplane cleaner, a washer, everything that wasn't fun. Then baggage handling. Worked my way up from that to became a ticket agent. And I flew for 2 years what we called a flight service director on board the 747.
Mm-hmm.
And from there I went to Washington, D.C. as a supervisor of flight attendants.
Mm-hmm.
And I met my wife in 1976 as a result of being, she was in Washington, she was in Boston, but I happened to be on the airplane and we met. And then from there in 1984, I went to Boston as the administrative manager of flight, and that's where I retired from in 1995.
Great. Well, thanks for all your time and showing us your shrine here as well.
Adam, thank you so much. I really appreciate you, your friendship.